Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the third day of the school on the physics of the early universe. We have Professor David Bourne continuing his lectures on perturbation theory. This will be his third lecture. Over to you, David.
Okay, thanks very much. Good morning, everyone. I hope you're keeping safe and well. So I'm going to move further into the topic of cosmological perturbations today. I spent the last couple of lectures introducing the key components. First of all, how we describe these perturbations and decompose them into independent components, both in terms of the symmetry properties of the perturbations, scalar, vector, tensor components of the perturbations, but also their decomposition into Fourier wave modes. In applying that to metric perturbations, or in fact generally to matter perturbations in an inhomogeneous cosmology now, last lecture I was describing the gauge dependence of these perturbations, gave you a long list of different possible ways of constructing gauge invariant quantities. So as I emphasize, these are really not unique, because the variety of gauge invariant quantities that we can construct are really a manifestation of how can be many of these can be interpreted simply as choices of gauge in which to study phenomena such as density or pressure waves. So there are many different gauge invariant combinations that have been used in the literature, and I'm going to today go through really how we apply these in the dynamical equations in the cosmological context, starting off with energy and momentum conservation, and show how we can exploit so we can actually use this aspect of gauge dependence in order to simplify the equations and derive some simple results for the behavior of perturbations, especially I'll study the behavior in the large scale limit. And then we can apply similar techniques to Einstein's equations. And one particular focus of that work is in reconstructing, seeing how these are consistent with Newtonian equations for the growth of structure in a simple cosmological model, the lambda CDM, lambda cold dark matter cosmological model that we use to describe the structure in our universe today. Okay, so that's the outline. As I said, last lecture I was talking about the gauge dependence in studying inhomogeneities in cosmology. That doesn't exist in the beautifully symmetric, maximally symmetric space of the Friedman, Lemaître, Robertson, Walker background cosmology, which we often talk about cosmology in terms of. But once we want to study inhomogeneities, we have this ambiguity in an arbitrariness in how we choose the coordinates, how we choose to identify points in the space-time with a particular coordinate map. And that's the gauge problem. I've shown how we can construct different gauge invariant variables, but these really are not unique and not independent. Because quantities like curvature or density are gauge dependent, then inevitably there are different definitions of curvature and density used in the literature. So for example, in highlighted in blue here, we can talk about the curvature in the uniform density gauge. I tend to call this zeta or zeta alpha if it's the density of a particular, just one fluid component. We can make a gauge invariant definition of this quantity. So curvature is gauge dependent, But once we specify the gauge, such as taking the uniform density gauge, then that quantity becomes gauge invariant. And it's written in terms of the curvature and the density perturbations in an arbitrary gauge. So in particular, we can give it in terms of the curvature and density in the longitudinal gauge, for example, just as one example given here in red. Those in turn have their own gauge invariant definition. So you can see straight away that zeta is in fact can be written in terms of the gauge invariant curvature perturbation in the longitudinal gauge and the particular gauge invariant combination with the gauge invariant density in the longitudinal gauge. And I've highlighted here, actually, we'll talk about the curvature perturbation for radiation and for matter. So you might often see these quantities, these particular combinations, the longitudinal gauge curvature perturbation and the density contrast for photons. And that in general could be different from the curvature perturbation, the matter perturbation in terms of the longitudinal gauge curvature and density contrast of matter. And matter here, I mean non-relativistic. Effectively pressureless matter. So that's one example, but zeta could equally be written, say, in terms of the co-moving gauge curvature and density, as I've illustrated in the bottom line here. So these are, and of course, these in turn are related, could be related to the longitudinal gauge quantities. So they're not independent, and there are choices to be made when we're it's just a choice of variables when describing the evolution of your system. There's a particularly simple relation between some variables, and that's when you're in effect describing the same perturbation. If we describe the curvature perturbation in the uniform density gauge in terms of the zero curvature gauge, then of course there's no curvature term when we try to evaluate the general form for zeta. We just get the dimensionless density contrast in this case. So here written as h over rho primed delta rho in that zero curvature or spatially flat gauge. And that means, of course, these two are then exactly proportional. And that's indeed, we expect to get a particularly simple relation there, because in effect, zeta alpha and zeta in the uniform density gauge and delta rho in the flat gauge are effectively describing the same thing. They're describing the same perturbation. Remember, zeta is a curvature in the uniform density gauge. Delta rho here is the density in the uniform curvature gauge. And so both of them represent the different displacement between the uniform curvature and the uniform density gauge. And so they're both related to just the gauge shift between those two gauges. So we can think of that as, in fact, what we identify zeta with is a dimensionless, zeta is dimensionless, it is just the perturbation in the expansion. It's just, you can think of this expression here as h delta t, or delta, this is conformal time, so delta tau, which is the perturbation in the logarithm of the expansion. So we could write that as the perturbation of log a, the scale factor, if we think about this as in terms of a sort of two different choices of scale factor here. So you get some variables like this related particularly simply. They're basically the same quantity with a different scale. There's just a different scaling between zeta and delta rho in the flat gauge. And they have this particularly simple interpretation as delta n, the perturbation in the logarithm of the expansion. Tomorrow I'll talk a bit about how we describe perturbations how this can be a very powerful way about thinking about primordial perturbations as being a perturbation in the local expansion delta n. Okay, so these are just examples of the sort of quantities I was talking about defining yesterday, and look back at yesterday's slides that I know are on the conference website. I see that there was a request to put them on Slack, so I'll put the slides on the Slack channel as well later. But the focus today is really focus on using now these quantities in the dynamical equations. So let's look here at the energy momentum, the covariant conservation of energy momentum. So the divergence of the energy momentum tensor is zero in general relativity, if this is the total energy momentum tensor. And so that's a very familiar form in the background. The only non-zero component of this this vector here is when nu is zero. The timelike component gives us a continuity equation for the energy density in the background. So the time derivative of density is given by, is diluted by the expansion. So we get rho prime is equal to minus 3h rho plus p. So the dilution of the density plus the work done by the pressure in that expansion. If we do that now in an inhomogeneous background, and we can keep just the first order perturbation terms in this expression, now we've got inhomogeneities in the momentum as well. So this conservation equation also implies conservation not just of the perturbed density, which is the first line here, so the perturbed fluid continuity equation, but also the perturbed momentum conservation equation, or as I'll call it, the Euler equation here. So we see the time derivative of the velocity, and in fact, it's the momentum, which is, so the shift the shift perturbation B, which remember was and here I've just written down the scalar parts of the velocity perturbation. So V plus B is the velocity projected, the momentum. So this was proportional to the momentum of the fluid projected onto the constant time hypersurfaces. So we get the time derivative of this combination V plus B, driven, you can see by the pressure perturbation. So delta P is the isotropic pressure perturbation, and pi I'll use is to describe the anisotropic, it's the scalar part of the anisotropic pressure perturbation. But for perfect fluids like radiation, this will vanish. And we'll see there's a simplification, of course, for non-relativistic matter, we can neglect all of the pressure perturbations. Nonetheless, the velocity evolution equation also has, in the perturbed background, you pick up a component from the time that the perturbed elapsed function in the metric, which is A. On the other hand, the density evolves due as in the background, it evolves due to the dilution by the background expansion and the work done by the perturbed pressure here. So that will change the density perturbation. But there's also a second term here, proportional to rho plus p, which is the background density plus pressure times the perturbation in the volume, so that you can also, of course, get a perturbation now in the expansion, which is c primed and plus the divergence of the velocity V plus E prime. So this is an example of some of the additional complexity of studying not just the perturbed matter quantities, the density delta rho, the pressure, and the velocity potential V, but also now we have to do that consistently with the perturbed space-time, the perturbed curvature, off-diagonal shear metric perturbation, the shift and lapse perturbations. They all appear in these equations. So in general, we've got what looks like a more complicated system to solve. But remember, we have a choice. We can simplify equations by working in particular gauges. And when we're dealing with the fluids, conservation equations, now those will often look simpler in a gauge constructed to minimize or indeed eliminate the fluid perturbations, such as the density perturbation. So if we think about what the fluid continuity equation looks like in a gauge, in a choice of gauge where the density is uniform, well, that means that these terms delta rho can be set to zero. So I grade them out in the second equation here, if you can see that clearly. So I can basically set to zero delta rho primed, delta rho here, as long as we remember that if we're working in that gauge, delta P is now not an arbitrary gauge pressure perturbation, but specifically the pressure perturbation in the uniform gauge. Similarly, C and V and E are the perturbations in the uniform density gauge. So I've written them in blue here. And those, for instance, the curvature perturbation in the uniform density gauge is zeta. We use zeta to represent that, as emphasize that that is a gauge invariant quantity. Delta P here in the uniform density gauge is actually the non-adiabatic pressure perturbation. If we have adiabatic perturbations, then once you go to the uniform density gauge, the pressure is also uniform. If you've got any residual pressure perturbation left once you've moved to the uniform density gauge, that represents only the can only be due to a non-adiabatic part of the pressure perturbation. So these, once we drop the density perturbations, we need to interpret delta P, C, etc., as the gauge invariant combinations of non-adiabatic pressure, zeta, and V plus E primed. I haven't given it a different name, but it is the, you can actually check that it is also a gauge invariant combination, V plus E primed. And so it must be the V plus E primed in the spatially flat gauge. And so already we've instead of this being a equation of motion for density perturbations, if we're in a uniform density gauge, we've eliminated those density perturbations. And in fact, what we're left with is an evolution equation for the first order evolution equation, just for the curvature perturbation in this gauge. So if we rearrange the equation, we can see that the evolution of the curvature perturbation zeta comes simply from the non-adiabatic pressure in the system. And a term here, which is effectively, we can think of this as the divergence of the momentum in this uniform density gauge. And on large scales, this is an example where we can see a term which is just derived from spatial derivatives of the scalar potentials. So if the scalar potentials stay finite on large scales, then there's a limit in which the spatial gradients on large enough scales, if we're looking at very long wavelength perturbations, these will become small. And typically in cosmology, we're comparing these spatial gradients with terms proportional to the Hubble length. So typically on super Hubble scales, that means we expect to be able to neglect these gradient terms. And in that case, zeta primed is just proportional to the non-adiabatic pressure perturbation. And so we have a simple result that for adiabatic pressure perturbations, where we can neglect this non-adiabatic pressure, on large scales, where we can neglect this divergence of the velocity term, then zeta will be constant. So this is one of the classic results that we find in perturbation theory on large scales, that the curvature perturbation on uniform density hypersurfaces is conserved for adiabatic perturbations. So adiabatic perturbations, for example, would be if the pressure is a unique function of the density, then the pressure perturbations are adiabatic. And we see that here in this uniform density gauge. We see that if for a barotropic fluid, for instance, where P is a function of rho Once you go to uniform density, the pressure is also uniform. So there would be no non-adiabatic pressure perturbation. Zeta would be constant in this large scale limit. Okay. So, and this is particularly powerful. We see in many models, or for instance, of inflation, and I'll give you a bit more information about these non-adiabatic type perturbations. But for simple single field models of inflation, typically produce adiabatic perturbations. So this quantity zeta is conserved in the large scale limit, and it allows us to relate the perturbations we see at late times in the radiational matter era, long after inflation. These can be related back to the fluctuations present in the scalar fields during inflation. So just as we've studied this quantity so implicitly here I was talking about the total density, so zeta without a subscript on it, here it refers to the total density, uniform total density gauge. So I was looking here at the fluid continuity equation for the total density, but we could also look in a multi-fluid cosmology, we could look at the curvature perturbation for individual fluids. Define that gauge invariant curvature perturbation defined with respect to the alpha fluid. We'll denote that by zeta alpha. So that corresponds to this, again, the curvature and density perturbation in an arbitrary gauge. This is the gauge invariant combination, but you can see that if we're in a gauge where delta rho alpha is zero, then this is just the curvature perturbation in the uniform alpha density gauge. And similarly, we can look at the continuity equation for each individual fluid in the corresponding uniform density gauge for that fluid. So again, we can eliminate the density we're working in a gauge where by construction we have zero density perturbation. So I've grayed out delta rho alpha here. And if we think of each individual fluid as having a simple equation of state, the pressure for that fluid is just a function of the density of that fluid, then in the uniform density gauge for that fluid, the pressure perturbation for that fluid will also vanish. So if there's no perturbation of rho, there will be no perturbation of the pressure P. So I've also grayed out, and I will set to zero the pressure perturbation for that fluid. So the only terms in the continuity equation here are the curvature perturbation, now in the uniform alpha density gauge, and the divergence of the velocity or momentum of that fluid. So again, in the large scale limit, if we've specified that this is a barotropic fluid, then the curvature perturbation for that particular fluid, zeta alpha, the curvature perturbation in the uniform alpha density gauge will be conserved. So that's a very useful way to think of building up the total density perturbation gauge in a multi-fluid cosmology. We can think of it as coming from individual components, each of which has a conserved curvature perturbation in this large scale limit. So in fact, this is with David Lythe, we realized that this is a very simple conservation law for perturbations that's coming, of course, from the existence of a local conservation equation for a quantity. So actually, this is an example where we can go beyond the linear theory to argue that in general, if we've got a quantity, so here I'm abstracting it into thinking about a quantity X that obeys a local conservation equation of the form of this continuity equation for matter. So we're saying that X changes in the expanding universe, where we think of N as being a measure of that logarithmic expansion. So dN here would just be the Hubble expansion rate times the time interval dt. So dn is hdt. So x is a quantity that changes just with the local expansion, just as a function of its density. Y. So the time derivative of x locally in the inhomogeneous universe, but along each world line, it's just a function y of x, the local value of x. And that's the case for the barotropic fluid, for example, where the density evolves as a function of the local density plus pressure. So that is just a function of the local density in the simplest case, say the continuity equation for matter. And the perturbation quantity we're talking about here, zeta, is really just so along each world line, you get the same evolution for x. It changes with the expansion. It's the same function y of x. The only difference along different world lines A and B will be this constant of integration, basically where they start, where different world, when you compare the perturbation at A and B at a fixed time, T1 or T2, the difference is really just an initial difference in the initial conditions. So it's just an integration constant, really, this conserved quantity, a different integration constant along world line A compared with world line B or any other world line, where the local the evolution of the local quantity x with the local expansion is just a function of the local value x. And what we've seen here, zeta delta n at first order is just delta x over y. So the example being delta rho over rho primed times the Hubble expansion rate was the way we define zeta in terms of the local density perturbation, delta rho. So, but this applies more generally, as I say, to any conserved quantity in the universe. We've applied it to, well, the first example I gave was the total density. And so that obeys this kind of expansion rule as long as the pressure is a local function of the density, and that's the case for the adiabatic density perturbations. We all can also apply it for individual fluids that obey their own individual energy conservation for the energy of each fluid in the expanding universe. But you might be able to apply this to other cases, not just energy density. One particular case of interest would be where you've got some conserved quantum number, such as the baryon number in the universe. So the local number density of baryons obeys a local conservation equation. It's simply, if baryon number is conserved, then it's simply diluted by the local expansion. And indeed, we can construct a quantity zeta defined by the local perturbation in the baryon number, which would be a useful quantity in any epoch when the baryon number is conserved. So I see, Sriram, you have your hand raised, please ask a question.
I was just wondering, there will be contributions from the iso curvature, right? The zeta, individual zeta is conserved?
Yes, that's right. So when you've got isocurvature perturbations, you can still have the individual zeta being conserved. Now, remember, this is for fluids and fluids that obey, that are barotropic. So scalar fields, I should caution you, do not necessarily obey a barotropic equation of state. But once we're talking about radiation and matter, for example, that certainly once they're decoupled, then each of them and are no longer transferring energy between them. So already by the time of last scattering, the last scattering of the cosmic microwave background, then each of the zeta for the radiation component and zeta for the matter component, and certainly zeta for the cold dark matter component, are separately conserved. So I'll describe those in just a moment. Yeah, talk about okay. Because this is exactly how we can define isocurvature perturbations. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So here we go. So indeed, with a multi-fluid cosmology, the obvious application of this is to think about the primordial plasma, perhaps at the epoch of nuclear synthesis, or indeed at last scattering of the cosmic microwave background, where we have photons, baryons, neutrinos, cold dark matter. We can define a relative perturbation between, say, and the classic case would say be between the baryons and the photons, or indeed the cold dark matter and the photons. The conventional definition of the relative perturbation, this is called an isocurvature or entropy perturbation between the two fluids, is the difference between the two zetas for the two fluids. So from matter and indeed conventionally in the primordial plasma, the isocurvature perturbation is defined relative to the photons. So if we talk about the matter isocurvature perturbation, this is defined to be the difference between zeta matter and the zeta gamma. And there's a conventional factor of three here in the definition of isocurvature perturbations relative to my definition of zeta. So if you plug in zeta matter and zeta gamma here, you see that this is basically three times the relative perturbation. Well, it is basically the relative perturbation delta rho matter over, so the density contrast for matter minus 3/4 the density contrast for photons. And one way to understand this is that in fact this also reflects the fractional perturbation in the number of matter particles relative to the number of photon particles, and because the density goes as the number density to the 4/3, that's why you get this factor of 3/4. But the other way that you can see it, if you just think of this in terms of zetas, remember zeta matter and zeta gamma are defined as delta rho over rho primed for each component. And delta rho over rho, the time derivative of rho matter is minus 3h rho matter, whereas zeta gamma would be delta rho over minus 4h rho gamma. So indeed, there's a the definitions of just by what you're really doing is, I would say, is you're just comparing the difference between these two curvature perturbations for the individual components. Okay. So the isocurvature perturbation is the difference between these two perturbations. And indeed, the isocurvature perturbation for cold dark matter, or indeed for baryons, already by the epoch of nuclear synthesis, these are basically have stopped exchanging energy with photons, any significant energy with photons. They're effectively non-relativistic. And so zeta matter and zeta gamma are separately conserved. And so certainly the difference between them, the matter, the isocurvature perturbation, is conserved on large scales. The total curvature perturbation, we can think of equivalently as the total dimensionless matter perturbation, then comes from a weighted sum of the individual curvature perturbations. And so as you move in the presence of, first of all, let's go to the case of adiabatic perturbations. For adiabatic perturbations, zeta, all the different zetas are the same. So there's no, so zeta alpha equals zeta gamma, then there is no entropy or isocurvature perturbation. That's what we would call adiabatic perturbations. And if all the zetas are the same, then this sum of the weights is just one multiplied. And so zeta is equal to all the zeta alphas, and the zeta alphas are conserved, so zeta is conserved. So that's the case, and that's why, in this case, example of a multi-fluid cosmology, why the total zeta is conserved if all the individual zetas are equal. But if the individual zetas are different, then the total zeta will change, but it changes just because the relative weights of the different components change. So in the presence of an matter isocurvature perturbation, as you moved from the radiation-dominated era, where zeta would be dominated by zeta gamma, and you move through into a matter-dominated era, where zeta would be dominated by zeta matter, then the total curvature perturbation can change in the presence of a relative entropy or isocurvature perturbation. So we can understand very simply the evolution of the total curvature perturbation on large scales for these fluid systems, where the individual, the curvature perturbation for each individual component is conserved. Okay, so schematically, you've got this difference between adiabatic perturbations, where the pressure, uniform pressure, and the uniform density hypersurfaces would coincide. So this would be a more symmetrical situation compared with isocurvature perturbations, where, for example, the matter perturbations may be in blue compared with the radiation perturbations in red. If you've got a relative perturbation between the matter and the radiation, then the uniform matter density hypersurfaces would no longer coincide with the uniform density hypersurfaces. So you would have, and that would indicate the presence of isocurvature perturbations. Obviously, there's more symmetry in this adiabatic case. Okay, I should say the cosmic microwave backgrounds, temperature and polarization anisotropies now place very tight constraints on the allowed amplitude of these isocurvature perturbations. And they must be less, so S here must be less than about 1% of the total matter perturbation. So actually, the early universe seems to be that at the time of last scattering, certainly we seem to have a universe which is more similar to the top picture here, where the uniform matter and radiation hypersurfaces coincide either exactly or certainly they're within about 1%. As we'll see, that's a case that can arise, is natural, you might argue, could be naturally produced if all the matter and the radiation at some earlier stage were in some thermal equilibrium, total thermal equilibrium. Okay, so that's I think showing the same thing again. So let me come to that case. I see there's a question, so I'll take that question in just a minute. But let me just finish off with this discussion of the adiabatic and isocurvature perturbations. There's a specialization, a simplification. One way to think about these adiabatic, this special case, more symmetric case of adiabatic perturbations, and that can arise where we have, in effect, a single clock cosmology, even if we've got a multi-fluid system. And there's two obvious ways we think about this arising in modern cosmology. So one is single field models of inflation. Certainly, if you've got a scalar field in an attractor solution, so this is the case in simple single field slow roll models of inflation, where the Hubble damping forces you into a slow roll attractor, where So although a scalar field has 2 degrees of freedom in the sense you've got the value of the field and the value of its derivative, and this means that they are not in general barotropic fluids, but along the attractor solution, the time derivative, the momentum of the field can be written as a local function of the field itself. So in effect, along this kind of attractor, you really only have, you do have a barotropic equation of state. And if all of the subsequent energy content of the universe flows from this scalar field after reheating, for example, that means that the only perturbations present in the system would be perturbations of the scalar field. So this is what we would call a classic example of a single clock inflation, and that would automatically lead to adiabatic density perturbations subsequently, because all the world, different world lines, if you're in different parts, causally disconnected parts of the universe, causally disconnected after inflation, but they've been set up and they all follow the same subsequent evolution. And the only difference is this initial clock, the perturbation in the initial scalar field, which sets the perturbed expansion in different parts of the universe. But the subsequent expansion is the same. And so zeta is then conserved in that large scale limit. That's an example of adiabatic perturbations from a single field attractor inflation. The other way it might arise, even if inflation had multiple fields and multiple fluctuations on large scales during inflation, if at the end of inflation, the primordial plasma is in full equilibrium, that is, all the density of all the fields can be written as a function of the local temperature, then again, if the density is a function of the local temperature, then zeta for all the components would simply be proportional to delta T over T primed, where capital T here is the temperature of the system. And so at that point, you would see that there would be no relative perturbation between two different fluid components if they're in full thermal equilibrium. And in that case, again, the total curvature, you'd have adiabatic perturbations. The total curvature perturbation would be conserved on large scales. But there are important exceptions possible to that, because full thermal equilibrium here, I'm excluding, for example, statistical equilibrium where different components might have a different chemical potential. And that is possible where, example I was giving, where you have perhaps a conserved number density, conserved quantum number. So although baryons, for example, may even be exchanging energy with the photon electron plasma, but because the baryon number, if the baryon number is conserved, then there is a conserved perturbation associated with the baryon number, and that can't be eliminated simply by exchanging energy with the photons. You would actually have to create or annihilate baryon number in different patches of the universe for the baryon number itself to be a function of the temperature. So where you've got conserved quantities like and baryon number, as far as we know, can be conserved up at very high energy. So you're potentially sensitive anyway to the physics. The laws of physics if they give rise to conserved baryon numbers, then they could allow for the existence of relative entropy perturbation between different components, even when those components are exchanging energy in a partial equilibrium. Okay, so there's a simple case where you've got full thermal equilibrium and there can be no relative entropy perturbation between different components. But there's an intermediate case where you could have conserved numbers. There's the case where cold dark matter, after all, at some point is decoupled and no longer exchanges energy with the photons. Potentially isocurvature perturbations could tell you about the presence of those, would tell you about the existence of some decoupling of the cold dark matter, for example, or the existence of conserved quantum numbers in the system. Okay, so I've got one more diagram just hammering home this point about adiabatic versus entropy perturbations. As I say, the adiabatic perturbations imply that wherever you are in the universe, you're following all the different patches of the universe follow a unique trajectory in phase space. Pressure is a local function of density. Y is a local function of X at every point along at every point in the universe. And the only difference between different patches of the universe would be relative perturbations along this background trajectory. But entropy perturbations more generally would imply that X and Y can be separately perturbed. And that's a concept which can be applied. So it's particularly useful for these multi-fluid cosmologies, such as the primordial plasma. This is where the terminology was first used. But we can also, this is a useful concept more generally when thinking about, for example, about multi-field inflation in the early universe as well. We can define in the large scale limit, we can talk about perturbations in different parts of the universe being adiabatic or relative entropy perturbations. Okay, so that's an example of how we can use and derive results simply from the continuity equations, energy and momentum conservation equations. I haven't even talked about Einstein's equations yet, so I'm going to do that next. But I'll pause at this point. I can see there's one hand raised, and I'm happy to answer a question if there are questions out there.
Farman, please go ahead and ask your question.
I have two questions. First question is, as you said, if after reheating there is thermal equilibrium, as I guess was shown by Steven Weinberg also, that there will be no isocurvature. So if we find out that there is really no isocurvature, I mean observationally, so does that mean that we can't distinguish between multi-field inflation and single-field inflation?
No, it doesn't mean we can't. There's no other way to do it. But it implies that you could wash out isocurvature perturbations could be washed out. Yes. So in fact, in multi-field inflation, most multi-field models indeed assume that as you go through reheating, the reheating does indeed wash out any relative perturbations there had been between the fields during inflation. And then part of the reason for doing that often is actually, it's certainly the simplest assumption to make, because then you only have one perturbation, yes, to keep track of through the radiation and matter dominated eras. And there are very tight constraints observationally on the allowed amplitude of isocurvature perturbations. So if you find isocurvature perturbations, they would indicate, certainly in the context of inflation, it would imply there must have been more than one field driving inflation. as you say, if you wash those out, the isocurvature perturbations, you won't. It doesn't mean, the fact we don't observe them doesn't mean that there weren't multiple fields during inflation. We could simply have just lost that bit of evidence, may have been washed out by the subsequent evolution. But there are, so one would look for other aspects. And in fact, the key signature which has been realized in recent years of multi-field inflation could also be the presence of distinctive types of non-Gaussianity, local type non-Gaussianity in particular, can only be generated in multi-field models of inflation. So you need relative entropy perturbations in order to generate a local type non-Gaussianity. And even if you subsequently wash out the relative isocurvature perturbations between the fluids in the primordial plasma, the existence in the at some earlier stage of isocurvature perturbations could still be present in the statistics of even of the adiabatic perturbations. So you can still have local type non-Gaussianity with adiabatic density and pressure perturbations in the plasma. And we believe that those would be indicate the existence of multiple fields, certainly in an inflationary, or I think it would, as far as I know, that would also be the case in, say, a collapse type models for the origin of structure. So we need to go beyond the linear order, though, to see that. So we'll I will talk about that in tomorrow's lecture. Yeah. So yeah, good question.
Okay. The second question I have is about this definition of isocurvature in the literature. It's quite confusing sometimes. So sometimes people define, I mean, they say that if during inflation there are some other light fields like axion and something. So because they are light, their perturbations won't perturb the overall total energy density perturbations, and that's why they say they are isocurvature. So how is that definition related to the way you define as the relative magnitude between zetas?
It's consistent. Yes, that's fine. I mean, it still implies it, the so the yes. Yeah, so there's a very so you're right. People often so the notation isocurvature somehow implies that it's and typically people are then thinking of a perturbation in a subdominant component. As if a component which doesn't contribute to the total curvature. So that's sort of implicit here. If you look at the bottom of the screen, my definition of the total zeta, of course, comes from a weighted sum. I'm sorry, I didn't say the W's here. I should have said this is the equation of state. So the weighting for each component is 1 plus W, the equation of state for that component, which is where W is the pressure divided by the density. So basically the weighting is actually the density plus pressure for that component relative to the total density plus pressure. And so indeed, the matter isocurvature is sometimes called an isocurvature perturbation. So yes, I'm emphasizing that it's a relative entropy perturbation, but it's also thought about as an isocurvature perturbation because in the radiation era, the matter is subdominant. So if you've got a fluctuation in zeta matter that's different from zeta gamma, then that's zeta total in the radiation era is basically dominated by the radiation zeta gamma, and so zeta matter being different from zeta gamma is an isocurvature perturbation in the radiation era. So there's a small zeta matter being different would give you a small but subdominant contribution to the total curvature. But the crucial thing is, emphasized by the definition here, is it has to be different from zeta gamma. So it is really a relative perturbation. And you need to be careful. Sometimes people think that, yeah, you, for example, that case of the axion field, you might think of the axion somehow as being having no fluctuations. And then when you start studying the fluctuations of the axion as isocurvature fluctuations, you allow for some small fluctuation in that axion field. Well, and you can get misled by thinking that somehow you can have no fluctuations of an axion field in the universe. And that just isn't possible if there are already curvature fluctuations in the universe. If the universe is inhomogeneous, there's really no sense in which the axion or any other field can be homogeneous. Because again, there's no preferred coordinate system in which it would be unperturbed. There are always some coordinate systems in which it's perturbed and some in which it's unperturbed. So you have to ask the question, well, when you say the axion has no fluctuations, which coordinate system, which gauge are you in when you say it has no fluctuations? And actually, the closest you can get to have it for, so if you have an inflaton field with fluctuations driving inflation and then an axion field, the closest you can have to having no fluctuations in the axion field is really saying that the axion field is simply has adiabatic fluctuations. It has the same fluctuations as the inflaton field driving inflation. And that would correspond to the case S is zero, where zeta for the axion would be equal to zeta for the dominant field during inflation. There's no unperturbed background in which the axion can exist with no fluctuations. So the nearest thing to having no fluctuations is indeed to have no relative entropy perturbations between two field between the axion and the dominant field. Does that help explain what's going on? So when people talk about the axion having isocurvature fluctuations, they exactly mean that the axion type field would have some zeta, which is different. The isocurvature fluctuation is the perturbation that is different from the dominant inflaton fluctuations, for example. But that's there's a common confusion. Yeah. Okay. Are there any other questions at this point?
There was one in the chat box.
Yeah. Okay. So,
is it possible to form isocurvature perturbations in single field inflation if there is some feature in the potential?
Yeah. So, that's an interesting point. It's not easy. I think is certainly the case. So my statement up here at the top of the slide is it's not possible if phi primed is a unique function of phi. And it's true in the, as you have a feature in the potential, as you go from slow roll into an ultra slow roll phase, for example, you can have relative perturbations between the momentum of the field relative to the field during inflation. So that is an isocurvature perturbation during inflation. And if you end inflation so typically that's a transient effect. And then the relative entropy perturbation is damped out if you go back into an attractor solution. So if you end inflation at the feature, or at least close to the feature, then it might be possible for some isocurvature relative entropy perturbation to survive. That's assuming that the subsequent plasma, the photons and baryons and cold dark matter, you can create a relative perturbation between those two components from that perturbation between the field and its momentum. So it is possible. But of course, if that happens just at the end of inflation, then typically that corresponds to a small length scale during fluctuations on very small length scales. So I don't know of any model in which isocurvature perturbations would survive on large scales, because those would be scales that would, there might be a feature on those large scales, but you would then have a lot of, if it's a transient feature, those isocurvature perturbations would be damped out in the subsequent evolution during inflation before you ever got to reheating. So I think in principle it's possible, but I'm not aware of it. I'm not aware of a model where that actually happens to produce large scale isocurvature perturbations. It's possible in principle, but it would I would expect it to be limited to small scales. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. So I'll maybe move on then, shall I, to the final half hour. Is that right? Yes.
Yes.
My
yes.
talk. Yeah. Today, just to then having, so we've tackled the fluid and energy and momentum conservation equations so far. So let's have a go now at looking at the full Einstein equations. Well, full, but in perturbation theory, we we can at least simplify them down to linear equations. So first of all, a reminder that in the background, the Einstein equations, this is the Einstein tensor, is related to the energy momentum tensor, T mu nu. And in the background, there's a time-time component, which gives us the energy constraint equation. That's Friedman's equation in a spatially flat background. H squared is just driven by the density. In general, in Einstein equations, you'd get a time-space component, which is a momentum constraint equation. But of course, that's identically zero in the symmetric background, the isotropic background, where there's no preferred direction. Pardon me. So the only other equation we get in Einstein's equations is we can, in the background, is there's a spatial, and in fact, there's only the because it's a diagonal metric, there's only the sort of trace part of the space components. That's an evolution equation, which gives us the second derivative of the scale factor, or the first derivative of the Hubble rate here. Okay, so these are simple for the background, but now for the perturbed universe, an inhomogeneous universe, we will have separate energy and momentum constraints, and we'll have all the components of the space-space evolution equations. Well, let's look at it. We've already looked at the Einstein equations. I've mentioned them briefly for the tensor and vector components of the metric perturbations. So let's see what happens when we put in the scalar perturbations of the metric and the energy momentum. So again, we get from the spatial parts of the Einstein equations, we get evolution equations. And there are two scalar components of the spatial metric, C and E. Although here I've rewritten the E in terms of the shear sigma, which remember itself is E primed minus B. So we indeed, from the trace and trace free part of the Einstein equations, we get second order evolution equations for these spatial metric perturbations. So we've got the curvature second order differential equation for the curvature perturbation. And now this is in an arbitrary gauge, I should say. And that's driven by the isotropic and the trace of basically the trace of the pressure perturbation. And there's also the evolution of, equation for the evolution of the shear. Remember, as I say, sigma itself is E primed, E prime plus B. So this is a second order evolution equation for the metric, the other scalar metric, spatial metric perturbation E. So we've got, and the shear is just driven by the off diagonal, the anisotropic part of the stress tensor. So the anisotropics, the scalar part of the anisotropic stress. So we get these two evolution equations, but of course it's not just an evolution equation for the curvature. It's also, we see a term, we also get terms involving the perturbation of the lapse function here. And in the evolution of the shear, we get both the lapse function and the curvature perturbation appearing in the equation. So these are coupled equations for the scalar metric perturbations. And they're also subject to constraint equations, the energy constraint equation and the momentum constraint equation that you see here. So solving these in general, they're only linear equations. So in terms of, certainly in terms of solving these numerically, one can construct a linear codes. And so, for example, for finding anisotropies in the cosmic microwave background, these are exactly the linearized Einstein equations that can be solved through codes such as class or CAM would solve for the anisotropies in the radiation, but also consistently include the metric perturbations in different gauges. Typically, they work in the longitudinal gauge, or indeed in the co-moving synchronous gauge. They pick a gauge and they solve the evolution equations, including the Einstein equations in numerical codes. That's now standard to do. But in terms of getting an understanding for what's going on there, let's see how these simplify in particular gauges. And let's use the longitudinal gauge, which is one of the most commonly used gauges for really, once we're dealing with these full Einstein equations, it provides some nice simplifications. So this is the longitudinal gauge sets the off-diagonal terms in the metric scalar metric perturbation to zero. So we set the shift potential B to zero, and the off-diagonal part of the spatial metric perturbation E to zero. And then we can, so we're then just left with the lapse and the curvature perturbations. And those are denoted, there are different conventions, I should say, but here I've denoted the lapse perturbation by psi, the curvature perturbation by phi. Sometimes, I'm afraid, in the different papers in the literature use different sign conventions, different sign conventions. Sometimes this is minus phi. Sometimes A is phi and C is psi. So they also phi and psi are swapped around. So you just have to look to see what the convention is being used in a particular paper. Certainly when you're writing a paper, you should write down your metric. So you're writing explicitly what your sign convention is. So if we look at these, first of all, look at the constraint equations here, the energy and momentum constraint equations. If we write these down in the longitudinal gauge, this means that the in particular here, it's the shear term. Remember, the longitudinal gauge is the zero shear gauge. So we eliminate the shear term from these equations. So that just slightly simplifies the energy and momentum constraints. We see that the energy constraint has the divergence of the lapse perturbation, or the Laplacian acting on the lapse perturbation phi, plus this term here, which is actually a perturbation of the related to the perturbed expansion in the longitudinal gauge. And that itself is related by the momentum constraint to the velocity perturbation of the matter, of the energy and matter in the universe. But we can see that there's an obvious way to eliminate this particular combination, phi minus h psi. You see that it's the same combination for the perturbed expansion that appears both in the energy constraint here and the momentum constraint. So if we eliminate, if we think of using the momentum constraint to eliminate this combination in the energy constraint, then in terms of metric perturbations, we're just left with the Laplacian acting on phi. And then that is equal to, well, you can see it's a combination of 4 pi g times delta rho, and then it's plus from the momentum constraint, 3h rho plus p times v. So that's this combination I've written here. And I've written it out separately here because actually we can identify that what we're left with on the right-hand side of our equation is actually a combination of the density perturbation and velocity that corresponds to the density perturbation in a gauge co-moving with the fluid velocity. So this is actually the co-moving fluid density perturbation that appears on the right-hand side of this simplified constraint equation here for the longitudinal gauge metric perturbation phi. And it's simplified in a rather intriguing way that this is just a Poisson equation for the metric perturbation in the longitudinal gauge, where the source for that metric perturbation is a density perturbation. So this looks a lot like, of course, a Newton's equation for the Gauss equation for the source of the Newtonian potential in Newtonian gravity. That would be nabla squared phi being sourced by 4 pi g times the density perturbation. Don't worry about the factor of a squared here. The a squared just keeps track of the rescaling between the co-moving and the physical coordinate derivatives here. So this is the co-moving or coordinate Laplacian. Usually in Newtonian theory, that would be the same as the physical spatial derivatives. But because we're in an expanding universe, the coordinate derivatives, to turn those into a physical spatial derivative, we need to divide through by a squared. So it's the a squared is just keeping track of the relation between co-moving and physical spatial derivatives. Otherwise, this is basically, so in the Newtonian sense, a would just be a constant. We could set it to one, but in an expanding universe, you just have to keep track of that extra time dependent factor. But otherwise, this is basically a Newtonian, an equation for a Newtonian type gravitational potential. So indeed, the metric potential in the Poisson gauge, the longitudinal gauge, which is sometimes called the Poisson gauge also, it's also called the conformal Newtonian gauge, because indeed this potential we can think of as being like a Newtonian type scalar gravitational potential. And it's sourced just by the local density perturbation. But there is an odd thing in the density perturbation here is not the density perturbation in the longitudinal gauge. So life isn't that simple that we can just do everything in the longitudinal gauge. Or rather, if we interpret this as quantities in the longitudinal gauge, it isn't just the density perturbation. We also have to keep track of this velocity perturbation. And in fact, it's not on large scales. The velocity perturbation, this is actually delta rho in the longitudinal gauge is actually quite different from delta rho in the co-moving gauge. What this equation also tells us is that the co-moving density perturbation there's a large scale limit. If the Newtonian potential stays finite, then as we go to large scales, where these spatial derivatives can be neglected, then the co-moving density perturbation itself must become small. Okay, so the co-moving density becoming small on large scales also means that basically, therefore, the co-moving hypersurfaces in this large scale limit, they effectively coincide with the uniform density hypersurfaces. So we can also see a simple result here immediately from this energy and momentum constraint is that the co-moving and uniform density gauges coincide in large scales. And that's why, although I've talked about zeta as being the uniform density gauge curvature perturbation, if we work out what that is in terms of the co-moving gauge quantities, you see that it's basically equal to the co-moving gauge curvature perturbation plus a term which is proportional to the the co-moving density. But in the large scale limit, the co-moving density becomes small from using this Poisson constraint equation here. So actually zeta and r coincide in this large scale limit. So I've talked about zeta being conserved, but you'll see other papers work with the co-moving curvature perturbation r being conserved. To be further confusing, some papers refer to the co-moving curvature perturbation as zeta, because indeed these are in the large scale limit where these have this simple conservation properties, the two things can coincide. So there's a simplification and in this large scale limit that we see that these two, the co-moving and uniform density gauges, become, well, coincide in this large scale limit. Okay, but let's come back. But let's come back to the new Einstein equations in the longitudinal gauge. So we see we have this. So a very attractive feature of the longitudinal gauge is this, the existence of this Poisson type equation. A further simplification in the longitudinal gauge comes from looking at the trace-free part of the Einstein evolution equations. So the trace-free part of the spatial part of the Einstein equations. So in an arbitrary gauge, remember that gave us, this is the evolution equation, the off-diagonal part of the Einstein equations that gives us the evolution of the shear perturbation, zeta prime plus 2h sigma prime to plus 2h sigma, minus A minus C is driven by the anisotropic stress. Now, the simplification comes, well, firstly, from the fact that in the longitudinal gauge, the shear is zero. So again, the quantity that this is supposed to be describing evolving is actually zero. So instead, this really becomes a constraint equation. If sigma is zero, this becomes a constraint equation relating A and C and the anisotropic stress. And remember, A is psi, C is phi. So this is basically gives us an equation for minus psi minus phi. That's sourced by the anisotropic stress. But for many cases of interest in cosmology, in that primordial era dominated by photons, the anisotropic stress is zero. Even photons coupled to electrons, a radiation fluid, there's vanishing anisotropic stress. Of course, even in the late time, non-relativistic matter, there's a vanishing anisotropic stress. So for these kind of examples, we can neglect the anisotropic stress. And then in the longitudinal gauge, this, what usually is an evolution equation, simply becomes a simple constraint equation. The psi equals minus phi. The two potentials are effectively equal up to an arbitrary sign. And as I say, unfortunately, in different papers you'll find different sign conventions. But with my sign conventions here, psi is equal to minus phi. And hence we really only in the longitudinal gauge we really only have one scalar metric potential, and that scalar metric potential obeys a Newtonian type Poisson equation. So the only scalar potential in the longitudinal gauge is, therefore we tend to call this the Newtonian potential, even though it's a relativistic metric perturbation. There's a lot of interest in whether indeed in keeping track of any effect of anisotropic stresses would indeed cause a difference between these two potentials. So this has been referred to for people studying the possibility of exotic dark energy models or indeed modified gravity that might give you effective anisotropic stresses. Their presence would be reflected in some difference between these two gravitational potentials that's been referred to as the gravitational slip. Any slight offset between these two potentials would indicate the presence of anisotropic stress on large scales. So so there's interesting effects potentially in the richer behavior that's possible in general relativity, but for these simple case of vanishing anisotropic stress, it behaves just like a Newtonian type potential, a single Newtonian potential in the longitudinal gauge. Emboldened by that, the fact that we have a Newtonian potential, let's see if we can recover the rest of other Newtonian type equations in the longitudinal gauge. So if we look at the Euler equation, for instance, for this is the momentum conservation equation in general relativity to first order. It has, in general, has this more complicated form, but remember in the, first of all, in the longitudinal gauge, the off-diagonal shift vector B is set to zero. So we can eliminate these terms from B. Now it's always, the velocity is always driven by the pressure gradients. That's quite natural. So, but there's the evolution is simpler in cases of zero pressure perturbation. And that's, so this is, and indeed we would expect the Newtonian description to work where we've got non-relativistic fluids. And that's exactly the situation we think applies to our universe today, where we have this lambda CDM model where the dominant energy components are, well, a cosmological constant, but that has no density or pressure perturbation if it's a completely uniform constant, and cold dark matter that would have pressure perturbations and would have density perturbations, variation in the density of cold dark matter, but there would be negligible pressure perturbations. So in that case, we could drop these pressure terms here, and what we would have is simply an evolution equation for V primed plus H times V. The sound speed is zero in the lambda CDM model, and that would be driven by the perturbation in the lapse function. That's psi. And if I take the spatial derivative of V, then what we're talking about is of course the velocity, the three vector velocity, the potential flow in this for perturbations. So it's damped by the Hubble expansion, but it's driven by the gradient of the gravitational potential. So this is a Newtonian type equation for the evolution of the velocity. The velocity of particles is driven by the gradient of the gravitational potential, where that gravitational potential is sourced by the density perturbation. So these are indeed Newtonian type equations for the motion of non-relativistic matter. But bear in mind that the density perturbation is the density perturbation in the co-moving gauge, not the longitudinal gauge. So, so this coming to the end here, I will really just finish off with again. So the question I've sort of posed here is how we interpret results from Newtonian simulations, for example. Let's see if we can move on and. The picture here then we're thinking of is how much we can trust Newtonian simulations of structure formations in the universe today. Does it really appear from out of these general relativistic equations? It looks very tempting from the equations I've just written down. We've got a Newtonian type evolution of the velocity driven by a gravitational potential, but the gravitational potential is the sourced by the density in the co-moving frame. So which frame should we be? So how should we interpret, really? The question I'm asking here is how should we really interpret simulations of structure formation if they're using Newtonian forces acting in a in a fixed geometry. And my answer would be is you can use Newtonian simulations, but you have to give them a relativistic interpretation to understand them in a full general relativity. Because, of course, in general, we do have these full set of complex equations. Here I've written them out again. Now we've got the fluid and Euler evolution equations. We've got the energy and momentum constraint equations. We've got the Einstein evolution equations. And really, these need to be respected if we believe general relativity is the true theory controlling gravity in the universe. We can make the simplification to neglect the pressure perturbations. So once we drop the pressure terms out of these equations, it's true they do simplify a lot. And then what we've seen is that at least some of these equations, the momentum evolution equation, we can combine the energy and momentum constraints to get a simplified energy constraint equation. And also the off-diagonal trace, the trace-free part of the evolution equations, the evolution equation for the shear, these all simplify certainly in the longitudinal gauge. So we can replace the general gauge forms of those equations with the longitudinal gauge versions. But as I say, the source of the Newtonian potential is actually the density of the co-moving gauge. So if we look at the density in the co-moving gauge, it obeys this Euler equation where the density is diluted by the expansion in a Newtonian way, but there's the source term here apparently from the off-diagonal part of the spatial metric perturbation, the shear of the metric perturbation. There is a simplification that comes from the momentum constraint in the co-moving gauge. In the absence of pressure perturbations, it shows you that the co-moving curvature perturbation is conserved. In fact, there's also an evolution equation, but that's consistent with the constraint setting R to zero. So we can reduce in longitudinal and co-moving gauges, all of these relativistic equations reduce to these almost Newtonian type equations. And the only remaining thing we need to do is to realize that first of all, the Poisson equation, the source of that is actually the co-moving density perturbation. So it's simpler. It becomes Newtonian if we interpret the density perturbation as the co-moving gauge. And in fact, we'll also see that the fluid continuity equation for the co-moving density perturbation, we need to identify this term here, which is a shear type term in the co-moving Lagrangian coordinates. Actually, we can interpret that as the divergence of the velocity. That's because in the longitudinal gauge. So in fact, there's this sort of interesting combination of terms. So these are now Newtonian type equations, but they very clearly link the evolution of the density in the co-moving gauge to the divergence of the velocity in the longitudinal gauge. And longitudinal gauge potential is sourced by the density in the co-moving gauge. So we've got this interplay between these two. So we have Newtonian type equations, but they have a subtle interpretation in general relativity. So the growth of structure in lambda CDM in general relativity is the same as in Newtonian gravity. In the absence of radiation and at first order, those are important simplifications. It can be extended actually to higher order in perturbations in terms of the evolution equations, but we begin to see differences from GR in terms of the constraint equations. The constraint equations begin to differ from general relativity, and that's important in terms of setting up the initial data beyond linear order. And we can deal with radiation in general relativity in a way that Newtonian physics really can't deal with relativistic perturbations. And indeed, but again, we need to be careful about how we interpret. We can't use these equations in this form in the presence of radiation. So in fact, in the presence of radiation perturbations, we need to systematically construct what we've referred to in a series of papers with Christian Fiedler and Thomas Tram and colleagues. We refer to these as Newtonian motion gauges. So you can, in the presence of radiation, you can actually explicitly construct gauges that are consistent with the Newtonian equations of motion, but you need to keep track of the relativistic, the effects of the radiation on the curved space-time. And then you can use the relativistic Boltzmann codes to calculate those at first order. But it's an additional correction that you need to include on top of these simple Newtonian equations. Right, I think that's what I've got time for today. What we find at the end of this is that we've got relativistic versions of these Newtonian equations, which does mean that we can basically use the standard equations for the growth of structure that you will find in the literature that are derived from this, apparently from a Newtonian evolution equation. But in fact, as I say, you can see that that's consistent if you interpret it correctly with the evolution of perturbations in general relativity. But the density perturbation that you're involving here is actually the co-moving density perturbation in the relativistic theory. I think I had more slides, and here's an example where we can actually look at what the matter power spectrum looks like in different gauges. And indeed, it's the co-moving gauge density perturbation that has the standard Newtonian form. If you plot the power spectrum for the density perturbation in the longitudinal gauge, you begin to see differences in the density perturbation on large scales. This is actually the Hubble scale in the universe today. And so, there would be differences. You need to understand which variable you're working with in the relativistic theory. And that's exactly the application of the gauge issue in general relativity. Right, I'm going to finish there. There's more I could say about n-body simulations, but I'll have to refer you to my papers on that and come back tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll mainly talk, though, I'll look to talk about perturbations from inflation and how we understand that in cosmological perturbation theory. So I should stop there before I go too far over time. If there's time, I'm happy to answer one or two more questions now.
Thank you, David. There are a couple of questions in the chat box. I'm trying to see whether the participants are there. Okay, for some reason, I'm not able to unmute them. Maybe I'll read it out for you. Is a vanishing anisotropic stress specific to the longitudinal gauge or happens in general relativity in general? Because a non-zero anisotropic stress is often seen as a test of GR, according to my knowledge.
Yes, that's thanks. I should say more about the anisotropic stress. I only really briefly mentioned it. So let me see if I can find the slides where, let's look at the full equations maybe here. So the anisotropic stress indeed appears in the Einstein's equations in the off-diagonal terms. It's not specific. When I talk about it vanishing for perfect fluids, for example, that's not a gauge-dependent statement. So it's not specific to the longitudinal gauge. It's a statement that the anisotropic stress would vanish. In fact, it's gauge in at first order. It's a gauge-independent quantity. Because it vanishes, it's an example of something which vanishes in the background. There's no anisotropic stress in the background cosmology, So when you introduce perturbations, the first order anisotropic stress is automatically gauge independent. At second order, it will become gauge dependent. But at first order, which is, these are first order equations, the anisotropic stress is gauge in automatically gauge independent. It vanishes from the physical property of, so for radiation, for example, when I talk about radiation, I'm thinking about an ideal fluid with relativistic particles, but rapidly interacting so that it exerts, so that even if you squeeze it in one direction, it exerts an isotropic pressure because the gas particles scatter frequently and redistribute the energy that you put in by squeezing the gas in one direction. It rapidly isotropizes, and so a rapidly interacting relativistic gas like the primordial plasma only exerts an isotropic pressure. So it vanishes automatically. And for conversely, for non-relativistic particles, they're basically slowly moving. They just exert negligible pressure. So they may have an anisotropic distribution, but the pressure they exert is negligible. So no, it's not specific to the longitudinal gauge. That's a general property of matter and radiation.
So I can see. Next question is, what is the effect of free streaming neutrinos on the anisotropic stress?
Good. So this is related. As I said, for photons, for the radiation, for the non-relativistic matter, this is setting the anisotropic stress to zero is a natural simplification. Oh, actually, what I wanted to do is find this equation. Yeah, for the, well, in an arbitrary gauge. Yeah, here we go. So that's fine to neglect the anisotropic pressure in an equation like this for photons and non-relativistic matter. But it is true that the where this falls down and where, for example, the two longitudinal gauge potentials may not be the sum of them may not be zero would be neutrinos. That's exactly a signature of the free streaming neutrinos. If these are relativistic particles, they exert a pressure, but because they're not scattering, they can have, if you set them up with an anisotropic distribution, then indeed that they don't interact and rescatter to any significant degree. So they do exert an anisotropic pressure. And so this is an effect which is not accounted for in these sort of Newtonian type analyses of structure formation that you see here. So it's the effect of neutrinos basically is a non-Newtonian effect in that sense. It's exactly an example of the sort of effect that you would need to describe by a relativistic code, and the Boltzmann codes such as CAM and CLAS do describe those effects, and they would need to be included, and they break this simple system. It's a small effect, but it's non-negligible on large scales. And it's certainly modeled for example, understanding the clustering in future galaxy surveys. I know the Euclid satellite team looking to extract information about the large scale clustering in the universe. So there's a lot of work now going into developing relativistic models which include the effect of neutrinos, in fact, the clustering of neutrinos, but also the anisotropic stress of neutrinos. And it goes beyond the simple Newtonian description. So it's usually some combination of Newtonian plus relativistic codes that are used to model that. The other example, which I say, coming back to the question in the chat, the earlier question was whether the absence of anisotropic stress could be used as a test of general relativity. And in it, it's true. What I'm saying is that, say, for radiation or for non-relativistic matter, that we can neglect anisotropic stress. That's in general relativity. It's true that a possible signature of modified gravity could be a non-vanishing anisotropic stress. So to model the growth of structure beyond, so modified gravity could well, one effect of modified gravity could well be an anisotropic stress. And again, that would go beyond this would be again another non-Newtonian type effect.
The last question is, how does any type of interaction between two fluids affect the hydrodynamic equations? From a particle physics point of view, there is interaction between electron and photon. How does the cross section of such a process get incorporated in the formulas?
Right. So So I've been talking about radiation as a fluid, for example. So indeed. So you might think of electrons and photons and protons as being subcomponents of the total radiation density. Certainly when we're talking about the relativistic hot plasma in the early universe, we're typically thinking of photons and electrons as being coupled scattering. So I'm assuming I'm working on a time scale where they scatter frequently. So it's in that limit that you can treat them as a single fluid. Of course, there's a, if you're really looking on small scales or short times, the plasma may not respond as an ideal fluid below a certain length scale or on a certain time scale. There are occasions on which you need to take that into account. So I've simplified and neglected that. I mean, so it's worth saying, I'm talking about equations that I can discuss in a lecture. If you go into the details of the Boltzmann codes, and which would be a lecture course in itself, certainly the scattering of electrons and photons in the primordial plasma, that's exactly what is modeled by numerical codes such as class and CAM, which are trying to model the emission of the radiation that we now see as the cosmic microwave background radiation. And they exactly track it through the evolution from before last scattering, when these are efficiently scattering off one, electrons and photons efficiently scatter off one another, through recombination, when the electrons get bound in with protons into neutral atoms. So there's a rapid transition in how they scatter off the photons, scatter off the electrons, and move into, after the last scattering, then the photons propagate through an effectively transparent universe. All those effects are exactly the scattering cross section is put into those numerical codes. There is a transition from an idealized, efficiently scattering fluid before the recombination of the electrons and protons, and then the last scattering of the cosmic microwave background photons. So those are real effects that you need to model, and are included. But of course, that's getting into this territory of solving a numerical code. Yeah.
Thank you, David. There are no other questions for now. Maybe we can stop here for today.
Yeah, thank you, and look forward to joining you again tomorrow.
Yeah,
see you. Final lecture. Yeah,
see you tomorrow, David. Thank you very much.
See you then. Thank you. Bye-bye.